The same shall be addressed at the end of the upcoming session.
Now it's time to resume learning about the body's powerhouse. I request Dr. Lakshmi Kumar to kindly continue the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so much. So I do hope the audience has been following. Sorry, let me just do this. Okay. So I'm going to move on to the second half of my lecture. I sincerely hope that I was able to communicate something that was useful to you. So my second half is a little bit of clinical and little bit of perhaps what we need to know most, the role of the liver in drug metabolism, how the normal physiology of the liver gets affected in obstructive jaundice, the role of vitamin K, having discussed coagulation, how does vitamin K help, and the normal physiology which is actually changed in cirrhosis, right? So when we talk about drug metabolism and the final years, the exam goers just sit for their viva. So it's a lot of phase one, phase two metabolism which is spoken about. So these phase one is the simple, the straightforward reactions which actually involve converting drugs into more polar compounds that are hydrophilic and can be excreted in the bile or the urine. It's also possible that the phase one metabolism of drugs, which happens in the liver, also converts it into a product that subsequently undergoes phase two conjugation. Now, most of these reactions are actually catalyzed by the very famous cytochrome P enzymes, which are unique for the liver. Now, the cytochrome P enzymes that detoxify or break down drugs are located in the zone 3 of the liver, and I will show you how it is of relevance to us. So it's important for us to know that the drug reaching the intestine through the portal vein reaches the liver, where it undergoes biotransformation. It can be broken down into an active drug which reaches the systemic, and a portion of it will get excreted. Now, it is not that a drug has to be broken down either by phase one or by phase two. As you can see in this example, an NSAID is broken down by hydroxylation or the phase one reaction, and a portion of it is broken down while the second half undergoes conjugation. Right? So there are both glucuronidation and hydroxylation of the same drug, which happens in both phase one and phase two pathways. So now the cytochrome reactions are very highly reactive and potentially toxic. So we talk about the superoxide ion, the oxygen derived free radicals, which can damage the liver, particularly in ischemia, reperfusion and transection of the liver. Most of these happen in the context of the cytochromes. The cytochrome reaction actually begins by the addition of oxygen binding to the heme ion, and this oxygen becomes an activated oxygen when it receives a hydrogen ion or an electron from NADPH. The activated oxygen, when it gets inserted into lipophilic molecules like xenobiotics, forms a substrate for the oxidation reactions that can transfer a reactive oxygen to the target molecule. So, an cytochrome-mediated oxidation reaction can form free radical intermediates, which are part and parcel of liver injury. This is a schematic diagram showing the heme complex, the addition of oxygen, the formation to an active oxygen complex, and the role of NADP or reduced flavoprotein in its metabolism. So as I said, there are certain cytochromes that are specific and that determines the site of injury. Now, many of us would have known paracetamol metabolism, and some of you may have been questioned in your viva, why does paracetamol cause its toxicity when extreme large doses of paracetamol are consumed, as in an attempted suicide or sometimes rarely accidentally? The breakdown of product of paracetamol, which is normally metabolized by the liver, is N-acetyl paraquinine imine, which is broken down by glutathione. Now, the glutathione precursor is N-acetylcysteine, and this is the rationale for the administration of N-acetylcysteine in its calculated doses for the treatment of paracetamol poisoning. Now, on a hypothetical basis of scavenging free radicals during hepatic transection, N-acetyl is also given almost anecdotally, but forms part and parcel of a liver protection strategy. Now, the relevance of the cytochrome location comes like when you know that the cytochrome PE, which is necessary for the detoxification of paracetamol, is located in zone 3, close to the central lobule, and the pathological characteristic of paracetamol toxicity is a centrilobular necrosis. Now, in my earlier lecture, we spoke about the zones and their functions. The zone 1, closest to the portal vein, is responsible for oxidative functions which involve gluconeogenesis, beta oxidation, and cholesterol synthesis, while the zone 3, which is distant, is more specific for glycolysis, drug detoxification, and lipogenesis. So that's so much for the phase 1 reaction. Phase 2 involves conjugation to form, again, they would be less toxic and they are excreted, but this involves conjugation with glucuronide, with sulfates, with amino acids of glutathione, and these can also be excreted in the urine and bile. Phase 3, I'm not sure if all of us have heard about it, this involves the binding of xenobiotics to ATP, binding cassette transport proteins, and these proteins use the energy derived from ATP to drive molecular transport. So there are specific roles of this ATP binding cassette proteins, and defects of this can cause defects in bile excretion, in copper transport. Therefore, it results in canalicular injury, defects of bile excretion, or defects in xenobiotics. How much of the drug that you're giving is going to be taken by the liver? Is the liver going to metabolize and excrete, or does it have a cumulative, like the context sensitivity? And is it going to prolong for a long time within the blood? That is determined by the efficiency of the liver in extracting or metabolizing a drug, measured as a hepatic extraction ratio. Simply, it is a fraction of intrinsic hepatic clearance divided by the hepatic flow. So this is again the chart from Miller, where it gives you a table of the drugs that are efficiently extracted, right? So this would include labetalol, metoprolol, verapamil, the anti-blood pressure, and some of the antipsychotic medications. Whereas the poorly extracted drugs are paracetamol, diazepam, digoxin, valproic acid, and warfarin. So it means that the drugs which have a high hepatic extraction ratio can be metabolized by the liver just based on the blood flow and is not related to its breakdown in the blood, protein binding, or the enzymatic action. So if you were asked to choose, what drugs would you choose for a patient with liver disease? You would like to choose a drug that has rapid elimination. That's why you choose propofol. There is no redistribution of the drug. So propofol is good. Fentanyl or remifentanyl is very good because they're broken down by esterases. And you choose atricurium or sisatricurium, which have non-endog independent elimination. Another criteria would be if they are metabolized without active conjugates, right? Which may prolong, like diazepam and the products of diazepam and morphine have such prolonged half-life that they are, the duration of action is unpredictable and unsafe in patients with liver disease. And another rationale you would use is those drugs that have a high hepatic extraction ratio. So while we know what induction agent, what analgesic, what muscle relaxant, I find my students getting rather confused with what benzodiazepine do we give. And I think luckily for us, oxazepam, temazepam are not available. So it's only lorazepam. So remember that lorazepam duration of action can get prolonged. So it's not okay to give lorazepam on the night before. But if you're asked, technically drug with a high hepatic extraction ratio and inactive conjugates, lorazepam would fit the bill. We do use lorazepam in patients undergoing transplant as well as in the donors. We believe that we have not encountered problems because of delayed excretion of these. Right? So you have the elimination of drugs being related to either flow, which is typical of a high extraction ratio, where most of the drug that is present is filtered by the liver, by its first pass in liver, and therefore there's a rapid clearance of the drug. The second is a capacity-dependent elimination also causes dose-dependent or a non-linear elimination. Here, the drug's excretion depends upon the capacity of the liver to metabolize, and at point will reach when there are higher blood plasma levels of the drug, but the liver has not metabolized it, and you need to be careful by the administration of these drugs. Now, when we talk about how do you measure a person's liver functions, right? If you ask me to look into it, a telltale sign when I might find that a patient has some evidence of liver disease is perhaps if the enzymes are high, right? So what value is considered abnormal? Most often they say that a rise of 1.5 to 2 times the normal value may be acceptable. So the basic problems that you might see is an elevation in enzymes. I'm not talking about the more obvious states where one may have ascites, jaundice, portal hypertension, platelets, low INR prolonged. But if you're looking at mild degrees of hepatic dysfunction, like a mild steatohepatitis, then a measure of these liver enzymes is important for us to know that there could be a problem. So as you know, there are two enzymes, alanine aminotransferase and aspartate aminotransferase, ALT and AST. ALT is a more liver-specific enzyme. It is located in the cytoplasm, but it is very specific for the liver, whereas aspartate, although it is located in the nucleus, can actually be present in other muscles such as the skeletal muscle and the cardiac muscle, and therefore is a little non-specific. Similarly, a lactate dehydrogenase is also indicative of injury, but again is a non-specific enzyme. And glutathione transferase is specific for drug-induced liver failure. So what is the relevance? So according to the textbook, they call a mild elevation as values of enzymes less than 250, moderate is up to 1000, and severe is more than that. And when we look at liver enzymes, this is not a hallmark, but if you find an AST-ALT ratio more than 2, it is suggestive of an alcoholic liver disease, and a ratio more than 4 of disorders of copper metabolism as in Wilson's disease, whereas a normal or a lower ratio is suggestive of a steatohepatitis. Right? So what is the significance of these enzymes to the anesthetist? If any patient were to undergo a liver surgery, then I would prognosticate any damage that has been done during the surgery by a measurement of the enzymes on the first post-operative day between 12 to 24 hours after the surgery, right? So a normal elevation of enzymes is perhaps about 250 to about 400 is normal after both the recipient as well as in the donor. In the same recipient, if the liver enzymes were in the scale of 1000 or 2000, this would be very indicative of an ischemia reperfusion injury or an improper vascularization of the graft. So, again, if you were doing some, say, a hypotensive anesthesia, then that's a marker of ischemic hepatitis. And if you're using a Pringle maneuver, this could be reflected in an elevation of the enzymes postoperatively. And you need to know that as long as the enzymes are elevated, you do know there is some hepatocellular dysfunction, and you need to wait for the remaining liver to pick up and support to a near normal function of the liver. Now coming to liver physiology, I just move on to the second part, which is the biliary system. And the biliary system and the role of bile is enormous. Like, and about 30% of the liver diseases are diseases that are related to the biliary tract. So how is this, the metabolism of bilirubin is a standard exam question. Majority of the bilirubin that is formed in the body comes from the breakdown of senescent red blood cells in the reticuloendothelial cells of the liver, spleen, and bone marrow, whereas a very small portion comes from RBC precursors in the bone marrow and the catabolism of heme-containing proteins like myoglobin. So 85% comes from old senescent red blood cells, right? So how are we talking about this? Is the role of the red blood cells and the synthesis of bilirubin? And this is an eventual constituent of bile, which is a mixture of bile acids, water, cholesterol, and bilirubin. So if you look at this figure, the heme and globulin dissociate, right? Globin acted upon by the enzyme heme oxygenase, and this results in biliverdin. Biliverdin acted by reductase, resulting in the formation of bilirubin. Now, this bilirubin cannot transport itself alone. It needs to bind itself to albumin, and the albumin bound to bilirubin reaches the outer surface of the hepatocyte, where it dissociates from albumin. There is a role of a carrier protein for its transport into the hepatic cell, and here it binds with a protein called ligandin, which keeps it bound and also prevents a reflux of this bilirubin back into the blood. So through a membrane transfer, it enters the endoplasmic reticulum, where it is conjugated to form bilirubin monoglucuronide and then diglucuronide. This conjugation is covered by UGT enzymes, which actually catalyze this conjugation. And finally, there are transporters. The name of this has been changed, and this becomes part of the phase 3. It is no longer called MOAT, but as the ATP-related carrier proteins. And this is where, so you know that abnormalities in conjugation is the basis of Gilbert's, and of course the Krigler-Najar, which we don't see, but Gilbert's is not quite not so uncommon. Occasionally you find patients with partial deficiency of the enzyme uridine glucuronide transferase. And here at this point, at this level, you get defects in secretion of this bilirubin into the intrahepatic circulation or the bile, and that's formation of, that's a condition in Rotor syndrome. So this is again the tight binding of bilirubin to albumin, dissociation from the albumin, cytosolic binding with ligandin and then with Z protein, conjugation in the endoplasmic reticulum, and finally its excretion in the canaliculi to the bile acids. Similarly, the formation to excretion of the bilirubin, into the canaliculi. Now, the bile acids are the breakdown products from cholesterol to form the primary bile acids, cholic and quinodeoxycholic, and then secondary deoxy, which conjugates itself with glycocholic acid and taurocholic acid to form the secondary bile salts. Now, the primary and the secondary bile salts that are produced in the liver undergo an enterohepatic, so a very small portion is excreted, but about 15 to 30 grams of bile salts are reabsorbed from the terminal portion of the ileum, and they re-enter to form part of the enterohepatic circulation. Now, the role of these bile salts is in the emulsification and the absorption of free fatty acids in the form of micelles. So, by activating of lipases, it promotes a micelle formation, and along with that, these fatty acids allow the absorption of fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K. And we all know one of them, vitamin K, is important for activation of some of the clotting factors. So the functions of the bile include absorption, transport, and secretion of lipids to form micelles that will allow absorption of vitamins and cholesterol. Bile also helps in the excretion of lipophilic xenobiotics, cholesterol, and steroid hormones. Now, we saw in the picture that cholesterol is broken down to give bile salts. Now, the regulation of the formation of bile salts from cholesterol is regulated by an enzyme that is activated by the farnesoid X receptor binding with bile salts. And therefore, there is a check on the breakdown of cholesterol, which is converted into bile acids. So, coming back to the biliary tree, we just saw the biliary tree, the formation of bilirubin, the excretion of bile, and the enterohepatic circulation. As a relevance to our clinical practice, the pre-hepatic causes of jaundice is usually from an excessive red blood cell breakdown or due to absorption of the red blood cell from resolution of a hematoma. So hemolysis or resorption of a large hematoma, this causes an unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So within the hepatic causes, there are multitudes of causes. So you can get biliary atresia, as you get in a young child, that causes an obstructive jaundice. Cirrhosis, you get jaundice, that is usually a mixed type. Pregnancy has usually an obstructive type of jaundice of pregnancy, unless of course you go on to the more severe forms of HELLP syndrome. The obstructive jaundice is usually due to either a benign stricture due to stones or due to some part of the biliary tree, which consists of biliary ducts that coalesce to form a right and left hepatic duct, a common bile duct in combination with a cystic duct, which then opens into the ampulla of Vata. So an obstruction right from the head of the pancreas all the way up there can produce any form of obstructive jaundice. So that becomes a post-hepatic. So once it is beyond the border of the liver, it becomes a post-hepatic. So jaundice is classified depending upon the pathophysiology as pre-hepatic, intra-hepatic, and as post-hepatic. Now, having discussed the role of bilirubin and absorption of fat-soluble vitamins, it's important to actually say the role of vitamin K. Vitamin K is a fat-soluble vitamin that needs the presence of these micelles produced from the excretion of bile acids into the small intestine. This is a cofactor for the gamma carboxylation of factors 2, 7, 9, and 10, as well as protein C and protein S. Once it activates by carboxylation to these factors, they combine with divalent ions to activate coagulation. So if you have a patient who has an obstructive jaundice, say you have an ampulla of Vata, head of pancreas with obstructive jaundice, and he's coming for an open Whipple surgery, when you want to place a neuraxial blockade, you need to remember to look at the INR or the prothrombin time. And fortunately for us, this irregularity in prothrombin time is something which is corrected very comfortably by the absorption of vitamin K. I think a single dose is mentioned to be adequate, but most centers have this parenteral vitamin K of 10 milligrams, which is given over a course of 3 days, and it usually corrects. The same thing is seen in preterm infants, young neonates who come for surgery. They usually will receive a dose of vitamin K. There is a role of vitamin K in coagulopathies, which are seen in critical care. This the role for this is uncertain, but I think it's common to actually administer a dose of vitamin K and see the response when you're seeing an unexplained coagulopathy, which you don't know is due to sepsis, hepatic dysfunction, or due to defective absorption. Now, what happens to the patient when they have an obstructive jaundice, as we discussed, as some point of obstruction which could be within the liver or extrahepatic? Now, since the liver plays a role in the formation of the lipids, besides causing an obstruction to the passage of bile, there is also a retention of cholesterol and phospholipids, and there is a hyperlipidemic state. Triglycerides are unaffected in this state, and we said that a portion of these free fatty acids can form the lipoprotein complexes. In a case with obstructive jaundice, these lipoproteins circulate as a unique lipoprotein that is called lipoprotein X, which is capable of the release of inflammatory transmitters and will explain some of the sepsis-like states that one might see after surgery for obstructive conditions. So theoretically, a presence of obstructive jaundice, since it can affect absorption of vitamin D, can predispose to malabsorption osteoporosis. If the cholestasis is very, very prolonged, right? And if it's prolonged, it usually means it's non-malignant. It usually does not happen. Theoretically, you can have a hepatocyte dysfunction. This is very, very uncommon. But an obstructive jaundice can cause an impairment of the antioxidant defense responses, also results in mitochondrial dysfunction. And the impairment of this mitochondrial oxidative function and accumulation of bile acids predisposes to the release of oxygen-derived free radicals. Right? I think I mentioned this. If you see prolonged coagulation in a patient with an obstructive biliary system, you can give vitamin K. So what are the anesthetic concerns if a patient with obstructive jaundice were to come for anesthesia? Remember, the amount of bilirubin, the higher the amount of bilirubin, the more hyperosmolar is the effect of these bile salts and bile acids. If you don't hydrate these individuals at any intervention, these bile salts can actually deposit on the renal tubules and get predisposed to tubular dysfunction. So whatever you may do, I think the first order I'd like my resident to give if a patient with obstructive jaundice by going for some procedure, be it a CT or an intervention, he needs to be hydrated. You, if you're worried about the cardiovascular status, you don't have to give 100 ml per hour, but at least give between 50 to 75 ml per hour. And this is something that can be prevented. Beware of a contrast nephropathy when we are using it in this situation, because a combination of a high bilirubin and the contrast administration may... I think a fluid administration is the best answer. Some may believe in the use of N-acetylcysteine to prevent this. Now, the impact of the bile salts in a patient with obstructive jaundice is a negative inotropic effect. So I think I once read that the high levels of bile salts actually deposits itself on the conducting systems of the heart and can actually reduce. It's not the direct deposition, but actually it delays the rate of rise of the peak action potential and actually competes with the binding sites of the inotropes or the cardiotropic drugs that you may use. So it affects the rate of rise and the action potential, and you may not find the desired response to the administration of vasopressor or inotropes in a patient with intense obstructive jaundice. Sorry. So I'll just move on to, I think, perhaps the last part of my discussion. I might take about 10 minutes for it. Cirrhosis of the liver. Now, it's not strictly physiology, but I think it is important when you're talking about the normal liver physiology to know what is abnormal when it changes into a cirrhotic. So cirrhosis is a condition where the normal hepatic architecture is replaced by distorted hepatocytic cells, which actually heal by fibrosis and regenerating nodules. So the normal hepatic architecture that we so extensively described about the portal triad, the centrilobular vein, becomes completely distorted. Now the other is a space of Dissi, which is actually the lymphatic drainage channel. So the normal lymphatic channels actually pass through the space of Dissi, and these are taken up by the cisterna chyli. But when you look at the picture of what happens in cirrhosis, I know I've shown this before, this is the abnormal collagen deposition that happens from the stellate cells, which infiltrate into this space of Dissi. And this will prevent the normal absorption of the bile, and this leads to the progressive formation of ascites in a patient with cirrhosis. Now, when the normal hepatic architecture has been replaced by fibrotic tissue, there is an obstruction to the flow of blood. There is a pressure in the portal system begins to increase. Now, one needs to understand how one can actually measure the portal pressure. We can measure the pressure of the right atrium by putting a central line. In a similar fashion, if there is no non-invasive method of measurement of portal pressure, you only look at surrogate markers of the presence of portal hypertension, which could be a decrease in platelets or a decrease in the total count, which actually means that there is a replacement by fibrosis and a destruction of the formed elements by a hypersplenism state. So if one were to accurately want to measure the portal pressures, this is done by a catheter inserted into the right internal jugular vein. It goes down the lower IVC of the right atrium, becomes infradiaphragmatic, and is then positioned to enter the hepatic vein. When you move the catheter inwards, there is a point when the hepatic venous, that is the central venous system, mixes with the portal system, and that is reflected by the wedged point of this catheter, just the same way you measure the left atrial pressure using a swan. So this is measured as a hepatic venous portal gradient, and the normal portal venous pressures are less than 5 to 6 millimeters of mercury. So more than 8, it is called as portal hypertension. More than 12, one would see the development of varices. If this pressure crosses more than 20 millimeters of mercury, it allows the development of spontaneous variceal hemorrhages. Ascites, as I've told you, it's not merely a low protein. It is actually a transudation because of imperfect lymphatic absorption and feedback mechanisms which happen in a disturbed liver. So the gradient is low. It's a transudate that happens from the liver into the abdomen and may predispose to the development of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. The extreme splanchnic vasodilatation that I described can predispose to acute kidney injury, which is called as hepatorenal syndrome. And because of the impact of inadequate metabolized the urea cycle enzymes and the breakdown of ammonia, one can get encephalopathy. And jaundice is in cirrhosis is not just obstructive. You get a mixture of both obstructive and non-obstructive bilirubin components, and it merely represents a hepatocellular dysfunction. Right? So this is a picture of a patient who has to undergo an incidental surgery, and you see these cirrhotic nodules, which may sometimes just be picked up. So what are the solutions? So this is a distorted sinusoidal architecture. Now, why does the splanchnic system vasodilate? As I said, the normally occurring vasodilators within the hepatic vasculature actually get relocated. So you might get dilated pulmonary arteriovenous channels. So what happens if there are dilated pulmonary arteriovenous channels? When you see the pulmonary artery with very significant dilatation, this actually bypasses, it behaves like a shunt and does not undergo the normal oxygenation that happens at the level of the alveoli and can result in more and more of deoxygenated blood directly entering the left system, which manifests itself as a hepatopulmonary syndrome. This is a schematic picture showing the esophagus with the development of small varices and of course a larger worm-like varices. If you put a Ryle's tube or sometimes decide you want to do a transesophageal echocardiography in that patient, beware. The varices are very extensive. They go all the way up. And we've had a patient who's bled a liter and a half from an esophageal probe. So that is the impact of an improperly placed probe. So TIPS is a transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic stent, which stents the hepatic vein and the portal vein, a self-expandable kind of a conduit, which is opened up between the hepatic vein and the portal vein. And the indication for doing a TIPS is refractory ascites or recurrent variceal hemorrhage. The one important contraindication for the performance of a TIPS is a right heart failure. Because the reason being, TIPS allows the opening of elevated portal pressures into the central venous system, which is the IVC and the venous reservoir of the body. And if the patient were in a right heart failure, which is already a right heart volume overloaded state, you would only worsen it. So that is the only major contraindication for the performance of TIPS. I told you about the hepatopulmonary syndrome and bypassing the pulmonary arteriovenous channels. This is a hepatopulmonary syndrome of an older child who presented with a cyanosis and a room air saturation of about 78. His PaO2 was about 45 millimeters. He did undergo a successful transplant, although he had a reinfection subsequently. So just to sum up, one of the pathological alterations and perhaps the commonest pathological alteration in the liver physiology is cirrhosis. It has multisystemic manifestations. The altered physiology may pose a challenge, but understanding the basic physiology would help to optimize the management. That's the end of my slideshow, and I'm happy to take any questions that you may have.
Thank you, ma'am, for simplifying such intricate physiological concepts for our audience. We have some questions from them. The first question is by Dr. Roshan Rao. He asks, how does the use of novel anticoagulant drugs in a patient of atrial fibrillation affect their liver function?
Sorry, it's raining very heavily here and I can't hear your voice too well. Would you say that again, please? Novel?
Yes, ma'am. How does the use of novel anticoagulant agents in atrial fibrillation patients affect their liver function?
Anticoagulants in patients with atrial fibrillation, is it in the context of liver disease?
The question does not mention it, ma'am, but I think that's what the person might mean.
Having atrial fibrillation, then you decide to choose which of these you would like, whichever drugs that you would like to give. If the patient had an acute onset, you would perhaps start with a rate controlling drug. A pharmacological management of atrial fibrillation is cordrone. Cordrone does have hepatotoxicity. So if would I give it to a patient who has a liver disease? It depends upon the pros and cons. So if the atrial fibrillation were resistant and I believe is causing a hemodynamic compromise, I perhaps would be comfortable to use it. But I would like to stop it as early as possible so that the side effects are minimal.
Thank you, ma'am. Our next question is by Dr. Tushar. In CLD, considering that both procoagulants and anticoagulants are affected, what should be our indicator preoperatively for safely administering uraxial anesthesia? And also, would TEG be a better indicator in these patients?
Yeah, Tushar, it's a very nice question. And unfortunately, nobody in the world has a right answer as of today. I hope 5 years later, I'm here to say that we have answers. So you're dead right that there is a balance of pro and anticoagulants in chronic liver disease. But in anybody who is child B and child C, a uraxial blockade is a no-no, right? Fortunately for us, with the advent of the ultrasound, it has allowed us the use of like abdominal plane blocks, erector spinae blocks, right? I met somebody who said that in recipients, they put bilateral erector spinae catheters, right? So it is so safe to use without a major risk of bleed inside a closed space, as would a spinal or an epidural. So a TEG would be indicative. Unfortunately, a TEG or a Rotem, unfortunately, there are no guidelines to say that if my TEG value was so much, I can put a uraxial blockade. You understand? We know that a TEG and a Rotem is a more novel and far more accurate way of telling us how the body's coagulation is. But does that give me a right to use an anticoagulation for DVT prophylaxis or to put a uraxial blockade? I think at this point in time, the answer is, I don't think anybody has a clear answer. People are still experimenting. You know, if I told myself that INR 1.5 or above, I will not give the patient low molecular weight heparin or Arixtra as part of DVT, but I find that his TEG is showing a hypercoagulable trace, I may be a little brave to administer one dose, right, with my epidural catheter, but that is, I am taking the entire responsibility. It is not given in the books. If something were to happen in the patient, there's nobody to protect you. And there is Claude, whoever who's done the Rotem and everything, gave me a reason why they haven't been able to extrapolate a value of TEG or Rotem. Because you need to do it as a randomized study and we are not probably willing to do that. So it's a very, very nice and pertinent question. The answers are unclear. But believe me, there's one thing that when you see, not in a recipient, in a donor, when you see an INR of 1.9 or 2, please never, never, ever give FFP saying you want to correct it because your epidural catheter is in situ, because that is a red herring. If you do a TEG or Rotem for him, it's normal because fibrinogen is an acute phase reactant which kicks up after a surgery. So that patient is actually hypercoagulable. Don't give him FFP. You'd probably run a risk of causing an embolism.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Our next question is by Dr. Pratap G. He asks, how does regional anesthesia affect hepatic arterial buffer response?
Regional anesthesia per se does not affect the response. It's only Halothane which does. Regional anesthesia's impact is only because of its reduction in mean arterial pressure reductions. So if you were smart enough to use a drug volume that didn't change the map or use pressors judiciously, right, you perhaps will not cause any hepatic damage.
Next question is by Dr. Vasudha. What is the role of perioperative albumin transfusion in a case of CLD?
Right. So albumin has, there are some indications when albumin needs to be given, right? Some of them are like, you know, it's burns, very rarely in renal disorders. In the setting of liver disease, albumin is given when you're trying to treat a acute kidney injury or a hepatorenal syndrome. So this albumin is part of volume expansion, right? It is not to get the serum level of albumin from 2.5 to 3.5 so that his child score or MELD score gets altered. It is merely as a volume expander, right? And because the safety of synthetic colloids such as starches or gelafusins is not proven in patients with liver disease. If you ask me what colloid am I comfortable to a patient with CLD, I would only pick albumin, right? So in CLDs, you need to do volume restriction. You can't give them too much of fluids because they already have an overload of extracellular fluid. You want to maintain the volume. You want to give a good dosage. So for the expansion of a proper volume expander, in the treatment of ascites, right, you need to give 8 grams of albumin for every liter of ascites that is tapped as a replacement for ascites, as a volume expander in acute kidney injury, as a colloid replacement in surgeries where there is a loss and until you get probably products. That would be my indication for transfusion of albumin. I'm just going to move to another room. So if I'm offline for a minute, please excuse me. I'm just going down.
Sure, ma'am.
KK, current went off.
Shall I move on to the next question, ma'am?
Yeah, you can. I'm hearing you, so please go on.
Yes, ma'am. Our next question is, what adjustment in the dose of local anesthetic would you recommend for regional block in a known case of CLD?
What reduction in dose of local anesthetic?
Local anesthetic.
If you actually saw the drugs which have high hepatic extraction, if I'm not mistaken, lidocaine is there. So we consciously don't reduce the dose of the drugs, but most of our procedures are tailored to within what we believe is a safe dose. So if I were to give an abdominal wall block, I'd probably give something like 40 ml of 0.25, which is about 20 ml of 0.25% bupivacaine to give me analgesia for a block. And if it were just a sole block, like a rectus abdominis for a hernia, I might use about 20 ml of 0.5%. So when I'm using an abdominal wall block, I'm aware that I need to use adequate volumes and just stick to the safe dose. Don't really do dosage modifications.
Thank you, ma'am. Our next question is, how do you assess the fluid status intraoperatively in a case of CLD undergoing major surgery, and what is your fluid of choice intraoperatively?
Right. That person really knew my heart. Okay. So in a CLD, the central venous pressure measurement in most patients is not supposed to be reflective of fluid status. Less so in a CLD patient because you have some degree of volume overload that causes a rise in CVP. So if you really want to measure fluid parameters, you need to have dynamic indices such as pulse pressure variation and stroke volume variation. So some anesthesia workstation monitors have this PPV, which is integrated to their system. So you may be able to calculate that. So the peak systolic, the maximum systolic minus minimum systolic divided by the mean, if that value is less than about 12%, then you're adequately fluid filled. Right. For some of us who may not have the privileges of this, I think I would just look on hemodynamics and perhaps urine output if there's no renal compromise. So you definitely, if your goal is I want to have absolute fluid monitoring, you need to have at least dynamic indices. Otherwise, of course, a transesophageal echocardiography or an IVC measurement where surgeries where an access may be possible. Those are the only ways of telling you of how much fluid there is. But if you have a PPV or an SVV less than 10 and a PPV which is less than 12 are superb indices of telling you that your fluid status is adequate. And if it's an abdominal surgery, a surgeon will tell you when the IVC is too full because it hampers with this resection. Regarding the choice of fluids, I did make a mention to this a little earlier that as a rule, when it is a hepatic resection, because I like to use lactate as a sensitive marker of both tissue perfusion and hepatic function, I avoid any fluid that contains lactate as its base, as for example, ringer lactate. So I choose a fluid that contains acetate, which could be plasmalite or cabilite. Even the isolite P contains acetate as its base, but that is not recommended because it has too much glucose that I don't want to use. So plasmalite is my fluid of choice. It is isotonic with the plasma, sodium of 140, potassium of 4, contains an acetate of about 27, also has a gluconate of 23, which is there just for balancing and is actually excreted. It maintains the alkalosis and does not cause a dilutional acidosis, which I see with normal saline. So my answer is for crystalloid would be plasmalite. Patient with proven liver disease, albumin would be my only colloid. Patient with liver dysfunction, I'd be very careful to kind of give products a little preemptively because once the liver becomes dysfunctional and you kind of cross that threshold, it becomes a vicious cycle of bleeding, which is difficult to manage.
Thank you, ma'am. Our next question is from Dr. Jananesh Kamath. He asks, why is glutathione indicative of drug injury?
Why is it indicative of drug injury? I must confess, I don't know too much about that. Perhaps it's given in Miller. It is drug, they say that it is very sensitive marker for drug-related hepatic injury. I am unable to clarify why. I'm sorry.
Ma'am, our next question and the last one for today's session is by Dr. Mohammed Sharif. What is the difference between hepatopulmonary syndrome and portopulmonary hypertension?
I wish you would come to my institute to do your fellowship. You will most certainly learn that very easily. So, hepatopulmonary syndrome is a syndrome of hypoxia and dilated pulmonary arteriovenous channels in the background of portal hypertension with or without liver disease. So this patient presents with cyanosis and desaturation. And actually, this is one of the indications for a liver transplant. And the patient, the condition actually reverses. So the child whose fingers I showed you with saturation of 78 in room air had a saturation of 98% on room air when he was shifted 1 month after transplant. So hepatopulmonary syndrome is a reversible syndrome of pulmonary arteriovenous dilatation, believed to be due to excessive nitric oxide in the pulmonary vasculature and can be treated by liver transplant. Portopulmonary hypertension is an irreversible phenomenon manifested by the development of intimal fibrosis in the pulmonary artery, consequent to a consistent and prolonged volume overload on the right side of the heart. So a value of mean pulmonary artery pressure of more than 50 is a definite contraindication for transplant. More than 40, a trial with pulmonary arterial vasodilator such as sildenafil is tried for a period of 2 to 4 weeks. And then the pressure is reassessed, and if it shows a sign to come down, they can be taken for surgery. These patients may need drugs for the management of elevated pulmonary artery pressures during their transplant. The presence of pulmonary artery hypertension is an additional risk for morbidity, and this condition cannot be corrected by transplant.
Thank you, ma'am. We would like to thank you for polishing our knowledge of hepatobiliary physiology. As a token of our gratitude, kindly accept this e-certificate.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for being a part of this ABGAP family this year again. We hope that our audience is finding ABGAP 2020 educative and helpful for their exams as well as in their practice of anesthesiology.